Jesus has been addressing the scribes and Pharisees, and he alternates between the multitudes and the scribes and Pharisees as he's doing these teachings, as he's traveling with the multitudes. And now he's going to direct his attention back to the disciples, not to the scribes and Pharisees. 12 of the 38 parables that Jesus told refer to money. They refer to mammon, or the obligations as far as offerings and stuff like that. He covered that 1/3 of the parables. So it's something that we should pay attention to. I don't talk about money on a regular basis because I only talk about it when it comes up in the scriptures. And so as we're going through many of the parables, sometimes it's just a quick blurb, and that just tells us something that we should be aware of. But in this particular section, it's the whole chapter that talks about finances and money, and it's really not so much about the money that it talks about. We're not talking about what we should be doing financially. I didn't read anything in this study about what kind of car to buy, or what kind of house to live in, you know, what kind of restaurant to go eat at. I didn't read any of that in here. What I read in here, though, as I studied this over and over, is what our heart is towards money. It's really a heart issue, not a financial issue. And so when we look at these scriptures, we can understand that Jesus doesn't so much care about money. He cares about the people and our hearts. And that's where all of these scriptures are going to be directed. I don't believe that God established offerings as a means to provide for the children of Israel. It wasn't like he said, oh, I've got to come up with socialism so that we can now meet the needs of all of the people. So we're all going to give our money in so that we can redistribute them. That's not what he did. God was not interested in that. It was, once again, a heart issue. Everything that we learn about the Old Testament and the directives of God, the law of God, was not meant so much for God himself. It was meant for the people so that they could understand who God is through their relationship with him and who they are. Sacrifices were necessary because people are sinners. And so that's why sacrifices were instituted, to demonstrate the need for a savior, the need for some way to cover the sin. And sacrifices were only good for a short period of time. I'm sure of the fact that if I lived in Old Testament times, I would have had to have been a shepherd of some sort. I would have had to have thousands of sheep because I would have been going to sacrifice daily. I would have been bringing, here's another one, okay, and here's another one. And they would, you know, they had to be pure. They had to be spotless when you brought a sheep to, you know, to be slaughtered for sin. And, you know, so you have to have a lot of them to make sure you got a spotless one, right? And I'm sure that I wouldn't have done real well in those times. I have a hard time now. And I know all of us can kind of claim that for ourselves. You know, we have moments where we're good. Isn't it funny how we have like those good moments and we just hoping that someone catches them on camera or something like that, or, you know, someone noticed that I was being friendly, and and it's kind of funny because we all kind of do that too. Not that we intentionally did it to show off, but once we do it, we can say, oh, you know, did anyone notice that I did that? You know, and it's kind of human nature. So God instituted offerings early on. In Numbers chapter 7 is the second largest chapter in the Bible. You know, we know that Psalm 119 is really long, you know, but Numbers 7 is next to it at 89 verses, and it's all about offerings. You know, so it tells us that God cared something about this. He wanted to get a message through to his people. He didn't care about offerings because he needed money. God was not economically challenged, and he wanted a way to build his coffers back up, but he cares about the hearts of men, and he uses offerings to teach us how much he cares for others. And so he's going to use us to help others and to bless others. So this next parable confuses many people because it goes against everything that Jesus teaches. And so as he's teaching it, a lot of people are like, what is he talking about? This doesn't make any sense. So we're going to break it apart and get his understanding and perspective as we grasp the deeper meaning. Today's message is titled Financially Faithful, and we continue our chronological studies with Luke chapter 16, verse 1. Where he also said to his disciples, so now we see that he's addressing his disciples, there was a certain rich man who had a steward. And an accusation was brought to him that this man was wasting his goods. So he called him and said to him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account of your stewardship, for you can no longer be steward. Then the steward said within himself, what shall I do? For my master is taking the stewardship away from me. I cannot dig. I'm ashamed to beg. I have resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. And so he called every one of his master's debtors to him and said to the first, how much do you owe my master? And he said, 100 measures of oil. And so he said to him, take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. And then he said to another, how much do you owe? And so he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said to him, take your bill and write 80. And so the master commended the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in their generation than the sons of light. Confusing, huh? That's just, you know, it just doesn't jump out and make a lot of sense. And we can say, wow, that doesn't seem like the nature of God. So this steward is a manager of someone's estate, okay? And quite often they were slaves. These were purchased people that were trained at what they do. They say that in the Roman times, in the Roman Empire, half of the people were slaves at that time, were indentured servants of some sort. And so this servant, this steward, has this very rich person that he's... Now, that rich person had many stewards. And the stewards had different roles. They did different things. One steward took care of, providing for the feeding of the house and all of the people and all of the servants in the house. Another may be in charge of the properties and what goes on with this. This steward was in charge of the business end of things and selling the stuff that the master produced. on his farms. And he produced oil, obviously, because he went and talked to the person about oil. And 50% was a big reduction, especially because the amount of oil that we're talking about here was 3 years worth of oil. It was a large amount of oil. The wheat that we're talking about is 9 years worth of wheat. So that was a lot of wheat. And so he cut 50% off of the guy that owed for the oil. He cut 20% off of the wheat. He made some good deals. But this was a shrewd guy that was stealing somehow from his master. We don't know the details of it. But we can probably make a couple of assumptions. Here he is cutting the cost. He was probably overcharging in the first place. And now he's making up for some of that and taking some back. But obviously, this is the master's property. He wasn't supposed to be skimming off the top. Now, these kind of servants lived on the master's property. So when he is being rejected and fired as a steward, that means he loses everything. He loses his source of income. He loses his housing because that's where he lived, on the property. He's going to lose it all. He's going to have nothing. And he says, I don't know what to do because I can't dig. You know, and I understand a guy that has been doing white collar work, he's just been trading and selling, you know, stuff. He doesn't have the experience or probably the physique to go out and do hard labor. He's not used to doing that. So this is something that is going to be challenging for him. He can't do it. He just knows, hey, I've never done that before. I still can't. And, you know, I don't like to dig, especially in Fountain Hills, where you put a shovel and it goes in that far, and that was digging, you know. And, you know, I have to do it once in a while. And when I do, I just get out there and I work at it. But, you know, after I'm done digging, my back hurts, my hand has calluses all over it, you know, my shoulders are sore. I come in and whine to Cheryl, oh, I'm in such pain. And it's because I'm not used to doing that kind of job. Well, that's the way this guy feels. He's not used to doing. And Israel is very similar to Arizona in the climate there, in the land. It's for them to grow, and they have farms everywhere. It's all over the world. They have to work really, really, really hard to get those things to grow. But it's beautiful. Man, you drive around on some of those bus tours, and it's just gorgeous. You see all these farms on a hillside, and they plant it on a hillside, and they make it grow. And, you know, God bless them. And God said that's what's going to happen in the last days too, that Israel is going to blossom and it's going to provide fruit to the nations. And that's what they do. They provide fruits and vegetables all to Europe. And it's just amazing the stuff they come up with there. So here's a guy that can't dig and he's too ashamed to beg. Too ashamed to beg. He's not too ashamed to steal. But he's too ashamed to beg, right? You know. So here's the thinking of this kind of person that, you know, he doesn't know what to do. Oh, I know what I'll do. I'll go and make a deal with all of the guys that I've been dealing with over the years. You see, because it says in verse 4, I've resolved what to do that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. You see, they're going to be indebted to him because of all of the money that he's going to save them. And so he got 50% of the oil, 20% of the wheat. You know, the guy with the oil probably had a better house. And so he was looking to lodge up there. And he planned ahead for what he was going to do. He said, okay, I have no other options, but I will make the best. And I like when he says to the guy with the oil, he says, how much do you owe my master? He said, 100 measures of oil. He said, take your bill, sit down quickly and write 50. Sit down quickly and write. This was of urgency. This is a one-day deal. This is it. If you don't make this deal right now, I get this all the time on the phone. You know, your warranty's out on your car. If you don't make this deal right now, you know, your car will probably break down tomorrow. You know, then I find the guy in my driveway cutting my transmission line. You know, it's like, what is the urgency? Well, the urgency was he wanted to make this deal before he was put out of the stewardship. He wanted to get it done. And so he's a criminal. He's been stealing from his master. He's now making deals with these guys that he wasn't supposed to be making. And guess what they are? Accomplices. You see, they bought into it. Okay, you know, you just saved me all that. All right, you know, you're a much better guy. You're a much nicer guy than I thought you were. But that really wasn't why he was doing it. And then the master, in verse 8, commended the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly. Confusing, isn't it? That's confusing. Why would the master commend him? For the sons of this world are more shrewd in their generation than the sons of light. You know, here it is, the deal that was made prepared this guy for the future. He now had a place to go when everything was going to fall apart, when his servanthood was taken away from him, when he didn't have any other options available to him. Now he was going to have something to fall back on. That's what Jesus is talking about here. He says, look, the sons of the world are shrewd in knowing that they have to prepare for their future. They have to have something set aside, a plan to go forward for the future. But the sons of light, they don't do that. They're not planning for the future. That's what he's talking about here. You see, and that's the condition of many Christians today, in not planning for the future. Oh, I'm not talking about next week. I'm not talking about your 401k. I'm not talking about your savings accounts. I'm talking about the future. How much of your future do you plan on spending on this earth? I know some people are saying in their mind, as long as possible. But in reality, our future is in the future when we leave this earth. Eternity is a little longer than retirement. It's forever. It doesn't end. And so that's what Jesus is calling out. Here is your future. You know what it is. You know what your future is. It's eternal. It's forever. How much are you storing up in your 401k in heaven? How much are you planning for heaven rather than on this earth? Now, he's not saying give everything up and just be destitute until you get to heaven, because God blesses us while we're here too. But what he's saying is, what are we doing? how are we planning ahead? And it's not talking about finances, because really when we consider this, it's talking about our whole spiritual condition as Christians. It's really talking about how we look at life on earth, how we minister to others, how we love others, how we serve others. Jesus didn't come to be served, but to serve. And he did it in such a way to be an example so that the disciples and us, I want to clarify that. You see, we are disciples of Christ because we are servants of the Lord Most High. We're children of the living God. And we are learning from him. Now, he isn't here right now physically with us to show us and to demonstrate to us, but he is here in word. He left us his teaching so that we can know how we're supposed to live and how we're supposed to do things. When we read things like take up your cross and follow after him, it's like, man, I'm glad there's no crucifixion anymore, because then I'd be walking around this big thing and you know, but it still applies today. Taking up our cross still applies. Are we up to it? We're not talking about carrying an actual cross. If you want, I'll let you try to carry the one out in the lobby, but you'd be in trouble. Took four guys to be able to move that around to get it up there. So, you know, it's not about carrying a physical cross. It's carrying the cross of Christ spiritually in our lives, and so that we live for him. You know, quite often we think to ourselves, well, carrying the cross is easier than giving my money up. That's what Jesus is getting at here, that money isn't going to save us. It's not going to carry over into the future. That's just part of what helps us go from day to, you know, when he says in the Lord's Prayer, give us this day our daily bread, he was talking about really providing for our daily needs and praying for our daily needs to be met. So I think he does a great job for all of us in that. If we look back, a lot of times when we look to the future here on earth, we say, how is this going to happen? How am I going to be provided for? How am I going to do this? And how am I going to be prepared for the future? And we're looking at things from a worldly, physical point of view. If we really want to trust God, we can say, I know that he's going to provide. So I am just going to get my heart right spiritually and just keep my mind on him in going forward, in preparing for the future. And how much can you add to your stature by worrying at all? And Jesus said, can't even add an inch to your stature by worrying. So why worry about these things? Instead, pray about them. We worry too much and we don't pray enough. So the steward, he's looking for grace from these other debtors, and he's not earning their grace. He's manipulating them into giving grace. But we are stewards also, and we're stewards of God's grace. And he doesn't want us to hang on to it. He wants us to share his grace with others. He wants us to share our time with others. He wants us to share his love with others. And yes, his finances with others because it's his riches that he gives to us, and he wants us to share, to bless others. He ties this concept together in verse 9 where he says, "And I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into an everlasting home." Mammon is an Aramaic word for money. And if an unbeliever would be that devoted to their future, to be shrewd in their planning, how much more should Christians be devoted and planning for our future? Not our future here on earth, but beyond that. Henry Drummond once said, "The entrance fee into heaven is free, but the yearly subscription is everything." We're supposed to give up all for him. That's what he told the disciples that were following him, the multitudes. Many of them didn't follow anymore when he encouraged them to follow him, leave it all behind and follow me. And many of them said, "No, that's too much. I'm not able to do that." Remember, after he fed the multitude out in the wilderness, and then he went to Capernaum and they found him there and he started teaching. And he said, "Unless you eat my body and drink my blood, you cannot be children of God." And they all left. They all fled. And the disciples were still there. And he said to them, "Are you guys going to go too? Or is that too much for you too?" And Peter said, "Where am I going to go? You have the words of life." You see, they understood also that he wasn't talking about his physical body, his physical blood, that he was talking about being the bread of life, and that his word is the bread of life. We have the bread of life in his word today. And as we read it, we can feed on it. We can be nourished spiritually from it. He won't let us perish because we don't have spiritual food to eat. All we have to do is eat it. But you know, you can bring a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. Well, that's what it's like here. How many Bibles are out there in the world? People have Bibles, stacks of them in their homes, and they don't read them. They don't feed on them. They don't nourish themselves with the Word of God. And so they starve spiritually. And many say, "Oh, it's because I don't understand. I don't understand what it's talking about." Okay, well, keep reading until you do. That's a challenge because a lot of times it just doesn't make a lot. Well, that's why we also get together and have Bible studies and have teachings like this on Sunday, so we can get together and hear what the scriptures mean, what they say, and how we can apply them to our lives. The struggle is knowing what God means by the scriptures, what Jesus wants us to know through his teachings, but the truth is revealed to us as we read it and as we pray, and God reveals the truth to us. There are so many times where I read a scripture that I've read many times before, and then I read it over again, and all of a sudden I have a different understanding. Not that it's different, that it contradicts my previous understanding. It's different in that it means something to me right then. And it's fully compatible with what I understood about it before, but there's fresh meaning. There's something new. That's God speaking to me about something that wasn't important in the past, but at that moment that I'm reading it, it's important today. He wants me to know. He wants me to hear something. When you're reading the Our Daily Breads, and then as you're reading it, something just jumps out at you. Or maybe you read it in the morning, and in the evening, all of a sudden something jumps out and reminds you of what you read in the morning. It's like, how did God plan that? How did he know that that was going to happen today? I don't know. I'm not God. But he knows, and he makes those things work out. So Jesus said that we should take up our crosses, that the road is narrow, and there are few that find it. There are many things that Jesus tells us about our future and about the struggle in going into the future. It's not going to be easy. There are many churches that teach that if you're not living at large, then there's sin in your life. If you're not having all the blessings of God right here and now, that there's something wrong, that your spiritual life is messed up, and so on and so forth. That's not what I get out of the scriptures. See, because I am told that if Jesus suffered, we're going to suffer too. There are going to be struggles in our lives too. The difference is that we know that we have a Savior that cares about the details of our lives, and that he's watching over us, and that he's going to get us through it. And so that's the most important thing, is that we know we have hope beyond this world. We have hope beyond the struggle. We know that we're going to make it through. Here, Jesus is telling us to use unrighteous mammon to further the kingdom of God. You can invest your money now so that others will find heaven, and then they're going to be there because of your generosity. That's what he's talking about here in the scripture. Some people go on missionary journeys. They go overseas and they, go to places that I wouldn't go to go minister to people in those lands. Guatemala, Belize. I have a friend that goes to all of these places, and it's like, what are you kidding me? Well, he's like a master martial arts guy. Doesn't Huck have like a black belt in whatever? His black belt is blacker than most people's black belt. And he is just out there, just putting himself out there. He's so unassuming. He's not a big guy. He's a small guy. And he goes out there and just loves people to the Lord. And he goes to these unusual countries that some of them I can't pronounce. And he goes there and he goes and ministers to the people there. And he shares with them the good news. You know what? I wasn't called to do that. That wasn't my calling. This is where God told me to, keep working towards this. I didn't know I was going to be a pastor. I never thought I would be a pastor. But eventually, I just kept following what the Lord was going to have me. So if you don't want to go to some other country and go minister there, if that's not your calling, that doesn't mean that you can't have part in it. See, we all take part in that through our offerings. We have a family that's in Crete. Sean and Jackie Coleman with their kids. And they're over there in Crete. They've been there from the same time that we started this church. They've been over there. They went on their missionary journey back then. And he has had some major, major struggles. There was one point where they let him work, and they gave him a visa so that he was able to work and make money. And so things were okay. And then they said, no, you can't do that anymore. And they took away that visa, gave them a different visa. So they're still there. They're still ministering. But they have gone through such spiritual warfare there. It isn't even funny. Some of the stories that he talks about is like out of a thriller movie that is like too freaky for me to watch, And he tells me, some of the stuff that's going on. And it's like, but he's called there. And that's where the Lord led him. And the Lord has surrounded him with people that are wanting to hear the truth. He doesn't have a huge church. He has a small church. And he continues to minister there, knowing that that's where God has called them. And he sends us prayers, you know, prayer requests and stuff. And you know, his family is, they're getting older. The kids are growing up, so they're going off to college, and they're going for different events. One of his daughters at Wheaton, she's going to be in a swim meet coming up, and, you know, pray for that. And so he has a lot of stuff going on in his life. He actually was here a couple of years ago, and he came and spoke and told us some of what was going on. And it was kind of scary, but at the same time, you knew that God was working in and through that. Crete is not a very friendly place to Christians. They're very Orthodox. They have very traditional type of religion. So bringing just the gospel there, bringing the truth there, it's hard because people, hold on, you're crossing the line here. I just want to go and be religious. You know, I want tradition. And so it's very uncomfortable. So we support them. We also had another guy that was in Italy. He grew up with our son. They were teenagers together in Queen Creek. And then when he graduated, he went off to Bible college in Italy. Rough, huh? He didn't have the money to go to Italy to go to Bible college, you know? So he was doing missionary work and stuff like that, and he was getting support. So we were supporting him during that time. And then he met his wife there, and so they got married, and we continued to support them as they became the dean. He was the dean of men, she was the overseer of women, and they continued to minister there in the Bible college in Italy, and until they were called back here to the United States, and we provided for them to go off on different teachings and different conferences and stuff like that. They would go to different places, and we would provide and bless them with support for that until they got back, and then they ended up back here in the United States. And so they're in California now, which is, another third world country. And so as we bless others, you know where it comes from? It comes from you. You're the ones that provide the funds to minister to them. And see, I don't give a detailed report and everything of all our finances and everything that we do with the money that comes in here. We don't pass a basket. We never have. This is just part of the process of offering. And so when we get offerings, we take that and we put it into ministry. First of all, we have to pay bills, obviously. We pay rent. We pay the utilities. Equipment that it takes to do a live stream. It's a monthly fee to do a live stream, and it's not cheap, but it's what we have, and we are able to do that. We're reaching the whole world. We have people in other countries that watch our live stream. And so we're reaching beyond the four walls here. That's where the ministry, the money in the ministry goes. It doesn't go to me. I'm supported by a job. It does go to my wife, who is not all of it. Part of it goes to my wife because she's an administrator. She's been doing these things for years in big churches. She was in ministry as an administrator. She worked in women's ministry, then and pastoral support over in a church of 8,000. And then we came here and we helped another church get started. She was the first one on staff there. And we helped that church get started, and it grew. And then we came up and planted this church. So she has all the experience necessary to do church administration. And so we finally brought her on staff so that she's been doing it 9 years, and we brought her on staff so that she can take care of the administrative needs of the church. It's necessary to have people that do get paid, but we don't do that. Most of the other churches pay worship teams and pay, we are all volunteers. And that's what God calls us to do. And so we're good with that. The money goes back into the ministry and then goes out. We also provide funds for the Good Samaritan Fund. The Good Samaritan Fund is a local fund that takes care of people here in Fountain Hills and Rio Verde area that may have financial struggles and are going through a time of need financially. And we provide, give them what they need to get them over the hump and take care of some of those financial needs. Of course, we don't have this endless bankroll, but we have enough because we combine it with some of the other churches, and then we're able to help those that are in need here locally. So it's a local mission that we have here, and it goes beyond. And there are other places that we support people that are in need, even other pastors that are in need, and we provide financial support for them as they needed support for this upcoming time. So we're very blessed because of what comes into the church. It provides for all these things. And we look forward to seeing what God is going to do next, what door God is going to open, allowing us to be able to bless others. So the mammon, financial support, may bless someone and cause them to understand and know God. They may be unsaved, never had, and they don't have anywhere else to go. And they come to the church, and the church provides for them. And they may say, oh, you know, well, let me find out more about who these people are and why they would do something like that. And they may hear the gospel, and we may see them in here one day, or one of the other churches here that teach the gospel may have them stop in, and the next thing you know, we're going to see them in heaven. That's what Jesus is talking about here. Everything we offer to God freely, he's going to put to good use for his glory, and it will bless us into eternity. Verse 10, he who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? So Jesus uses this axiom, a self-evident truth, in verse 10. And no one will argue with this statement. Those that are faithful in a little will be faithful in much. Those who are unjust in a little will be unjust with much. And so he just spells that out and saying, this is just the nature of man. It's confirmed again by Jesus in the parable of the talents that we'll get to in a few months. There were three servants that the master was going to go off for a bit and do some travel. And he gave one servant five talents. Talent is a money. It's a value of money. I don't remember specifically how much it is, but five talents was a lot of money. Another, he gave two talents, and another, he gave one talent. And when he returned, the one that he gave five talents to had doubled it. The one that he gave two talents to had doubled it. The one that he gave one talent to gave it back to him. And he said, what's up with this? He said, well, I know that you are an austere man. I know that you're someone that, you know, you take and were in places where you didn't plant. So I just saved that for you and gave it back to you when you came back. So here's your money back. And he said, oh, you know, you foolish, and you're miserable. You're rotten. You're going to hell. That's what he said. Okay, maybe not that way. But he said that if you knew that about me, you should have taken that and give it to the bankers so I could have earned interest on it. Instead, You just held on to it and then gave it back to me. You're lazy. You're lazy. And you didn't do what you know you should have done. And so he then took the coin and gave it to the guy with 10 talents. Because those who have more are going to be blessed with more. And those who didn't have any will have even less. Back in our text in verse 11, Jesus explains in more detail what he's talking about. Those who have been unfaithful with their money will not be trustworthy with true riches. And the true riches are from God. He provides the true riches. A lot of times we think the true riches are financial, but that is not true riches. Peace, hope, contentment, those are true riches. If we get into a struggle, a trial, and things are rough in our lives, if we have peace through those struggles, that's much more valuable than money. I would rather have peace than money. I would rather have hope than money, because I would be content with that. But money, I always found that whenever I had large sums of money, and I did in my life have large sums of money, and I was never content. I was always worried about the money. Where's it going to go? When's it going to go? Who's going to take it? You know? And what president do we have that's going to, you know, enhance my money or take away my money? And I was always worried about these things. None of those things matter. God is in control of all of it. And whoever is president doesn't supersede what God is doing. And so they can raise taxes, lower taxes, do whatever the case may be. But when I trust in God, he provides. He makes sure that I have everything that I need. And I know that I'm going to be taken care of. So if we're born again, then we have a place in heaven. It's guaranteed. It's a sure thing if we're born again. But our position in heaven is still up for grabs. I don't think we think about that. I know that there are going to be positions. There are going to be places given to us to have authority over, we're told. You know, Paul, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, I'll read it so that I don't mess it up. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, in verse 12, it says, "Now if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones," now he's talking about the foundation of Jesus Christ, "wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. And if anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire." So here our works are put on the flame, and then it's determined what's left after that. Wood, hay, stubble, gone. But if it's gold, silver, if it's metals, precious metal, there's going to be something that's lasting. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego went into the furnace, and they came out not smelling of fire even. You see, because they went in as gold and came out as gold. They went in pure and came out pure. It says here that if you have wood, hay, and stubble, it's going to burn. You're going to come out smelling like smoke. But you made it. And really, that's what it says here. I'm not making that up. And so we want to be sure that we have stuff stored up in heaven, treasure in heaven where moth and rust do not corrupt, that'll be there for us when we get there, because we're going to be there for eternity. So we got to make it last. Now, I don't think we're going to run out of treasure in that it'll be taken away. We're going to end up, you know, halfway through eternity with, you know, just a fig leaf because everything fell off of us and we're all burned up. And I don't think that's the case. But the worst place in heaven is going to be better than the best place on earth. You know, we're never going to be disappointed about where we are in heaven. It's going to be a glorious thing. But we have the opportunity to be used by God here on earth so we can bless others and bring others to heaven with us. That's what this is talking about. Verse 13, Jesus continues, "No servant can serve two masters, for he will either hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon." Mammon, or money, is a master. It can control the way that we act, the way we live. We may live in fear because of the lack of money or the threat of money being taken away, the stock market crashing, a 401k crashing, the taxes going up, and we're worried about, you know, how much we have, insurance rates going up, the cost of living going up, inflation. And we may be concerned about the future because of money. It can control us. It can cause fear. It can make us afraid. We shouldn't live with those fears, because God is greater than the stock market. He's greater than the gold prices. He's greater than all of those things. And if our trust is truly in him, those things shouldn't make us afraid. We can rest and be assured that he's going to take care of us. Serving God means that we trust him with our needs, with our daily bread. Jesus teaches us to pray for that. When we are financially faithful, God will honor our faithfulness with blessings that we can't imagine. And many of them won't be visible here, but they will become visible in the future when we enter into eternity. Finally, talking about tithing and giving, there's no secret amount that we should give. There's no money, that there's no certain percentage and everything. The Old Testament was 10%, right? That was just for a certain tithe. The amount of money and offerings they gave in the Old Testament was up to 30% of their income. They gave till it hurt. But that's how they were ordered to give. But here's what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 9:7. "So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver." If someone comes and asks me, "Pastor, how much should I be giving?" I know that many would expect my answer to be more. But that's not my answer. My answer is, what has God put on your heart? How much do you want to be blessed on? 2% or 10% or 5% or 20%? How much do you want to be blessed on? When we give, do we give with a cheerful heart? Or do we give saying, "Oh, I'm writing this check and I could use this for my house remodel. I can use this for something important." What's more important than eternity? So I don't ever tell people what a percentage is that they should give. I say, pray and let God tell you. You'll know. When you write that check, if it's real easy to write, Maybe God wants you to give a little more. But you know what? If you can't give joyfully, then don't give. Period. Because it has to come from the heart. It has to come from the joy of knowing we're blessing someone else. We're helping someone else. We are going to bring someone else in the kingdom of God because of what we're giving. And it could be someone right here in our church, in our flock that needs help. And when we have the finances, we can bless others. We can minister to others. But I think it's also more important to say that we can pray and encourage others without giving a dime. We can pray and we can encourage each other in the Lord. And that's just as important as what we put in a tithe box. Praying, encouraging, blessing others, loving others, being there just to listen. Quite often we think we have to have advice for others when they ask a question, you know, and we have to have an answer, advice, you know. And as a pastor, I have an answer for everyone about every problem that can possibly happen. Go ahead, throw them out. No, I'm kidding. Don't, because I know some of you were thinking, oh, well, I have a question, but come talk to me later. But here's the thing. I know that I don't have all the answers, but I know who does. And so when someone comes with a question, like Nebuchadnezzar came to Daniel and gave him a question, hey, what is this dream about? Daniel knew who to go to. Daniel didn't try to figure it out on his own. He didn't take an online course in psychology to figure out what that dream was about. He said, I know who can answer your question. And he went to the Lord. My prayer is that you ask God what God would want to do with your life, in your finances, in your prayer life, in your marriage, whatever it is. You go to the Lord and ask, and He will be there for you. He will give you answers. I pray that God continues to bless you as you bless others, and that it would be an encouragement to you, that it would be a joy to you, and that it would enhance your hope for what He is going to do in the future. Amen.